all the fires and taking out the running spires. Light all the fires, it's a kingdom, he's coming home. Whoa, light all the fires, it's a king of the running spires. Light all the fires, it's a kingdom, he's coming home. Where shall we
today we're going to be looking into the mannequin is all set up basically representing a British soldier of the 1st Battalion Royal Hampshire Regiment circa 1969 in Northern Ireland. So we're going to be looking into that, and I'm going to dive into a little bit of the history of the regiment and what they were doing in Northern Ireland at the time. So in 1969 the 1st Battalion was based in Belfast during the so-called honeymoon period of the time. So you, in those early photos, you won't see them wearing flak jackets or anything like that. It's other than all like jumpers, their standard general service shirts of, I think, the 1955 style ones or the 60s style ones, a bit of a mishmash of that sort of kit of that era, and also just wearing their just combat jackets without protective gear on, like the flak jackets. And in some photos they'd be wearing helmets, but in some photos not. So it's a bit of a mix-mash of things of that period in regards of equipment and uniform. But it wasn't until, say, the later period of 69 going into 1970 where the wearing of flak vests was becoming more standard due to the more violent nature of the Troubles later in the year and going into 1970. So we will get on to the next part of the video. We'll see you in a bit. Okay, now onto the mannequin. So as you see before us is the mannequin showing a member of 1st Battalion, the Royal Hampshire Regiment, in Belfast in 1969. So I'm going to be reading a little bit of history about the regiment in Northern Ireland. So I'll get started. So I will be looking away from the camera occasionally, but I will be carrying on with the mannequin just after. So, 1st Royal Hampshire Regiment was deployed 8 times to the province of Northern Ireland during the period from 1969 to 1961, when their last tour was in Londonderry, I believe. Or it might have been South Park, I can't remember. 6 of these tours were short or emergency tours of 4 months, 2 were garrison tours of 18 to 24 months. Locations varied over a period from Belfast to South Armagh to Fermanagh and Londonderry. The battalion was required to operate both in urban and rural environments. While there were essential differences between the two, especially in terms of number of soldiers available to control an area,
the requirement for good basic infantry skills remained the same. A particular feature of the campaign was the responsibility of soldiers of the responsibility placed on soldiers of the rifle section commanders, the corporals or even lance corporals, who necessarily were given the freedom to exercise their initiative. The professionalism was key to the reputation of the battalion. It is for this reason that the campaign has been referred to as a corporal's war. The dangers faced by soldiers deployed to Northern Ireland included hostile crowds, sophisticated booby traps, sniper fire, rocket and mortar attacks, and even ambush. But a particular threat in rural areas was culvert or roadside bombs, frequently remotely controlled, which detonated after security forces had been lured into the area, into the vicinity, on a false pretext. What cannot be underestimated is the fundamental importance of good intelligence in the conduct of low-intensity operations. The Royal Ulster Constabulary, the RUC, with its special branch, had prime responsibility, but army units played a major role in the collection and collation of information gained from routine patrols and contacts with the local population and observation. So that's a little short history about the regiment in Northern Ireland. Now we're going to go on to the Manic itself. So starting from the top, walking down, we have the dark blue beret, which was a staple of most line infantry regiments of the time and up until recently, which mainly the dark blue beret is mainly worn by, say, the Remy, the Royal Engineers, or the Royal Signals, to that effect. So then on the beret we have the Royal Hampshire Regiment cap badge. They got the royal designation in about 1948, obviously with Queen's Crown. The laurel wreath, inside is the tiger denoting the regiment's service in India, and then the Hampshire Rose, obviously with Hampshire Regiment, Royal Hampshire underneath. The uniform itself is mainly made up of the 60 pattern OD smock or jacket, with large slanted breast pockets on the top, and then two large billow pockets down on the lower part of the jacket. Its most iconic feature of the jacket was the stitched collar, which was later phased out with the 68 pattern. And there was a 60 pattern in DPM, so disruptive pattern material, made also. But very, very common to see this through 1969 and 1970 and 71. Underneath the jacket we have the jumper and the shirt. Both these are both stand-ins for the correct period items. I don't have one of the jumpers yet, but I am looking to get one. And the shirts of that sort of period, the 1955 and early 60s shirts, are getting priced a bit tricky to find these days, but I am currently in the market for some of those items. But the jumper would normally have like a drawstring as well, and the shirt would be more of a brown colour than a green. So moving away from that, obviously I said about the jacket, the webbing is standard 1958. This is a mixture of first and second pattern items. So we have the yoke itself. This one I believe was probably a third or second pattern yoke, but has been altered in some way by removing the straps, sorry, the loops where the large pack straps would go through. So that's the standard one there. Moving down, we have the 58 pattern belt and the left and right ammunition pouches. So that's just come undone. And the left and right ammunition pouches. These are both second pattern, so basically exactly the same in design as to the first pattern, so they hang straight on the belt rather than the third pattern slanted ones. They have inside a pull tab, so pull strap, so when you lift the lid of the ammo pouch, it lifts up the magazines inside to for easier access, but it is a bit over-engineered and was gotten rid of in the third pattern. Also, the second pattern compared to the first pattern does not have the stiffener boards in the side of the lid. Also, this sort of part of Northern Ireland, you would have the bayonet, which was gotten rid of went on tour in Northern Ireland later on in the Troubles, because it was seen as a bit of a more of a hindrance and a danger to the soldier carrying it than if he wasn't carrying it, because someone, say in a riot situation or in a crowd control situation, one of the crowd could get hold of the bayonet and then use it on the previous owner. So the bayonets on this side, because you would see troops, early photos of British troops in Northern Ireland with bayonets fixed, lining the streets. On the other side is the pouch for the Energa rifle grenade adapter. This wasn't really used. I think it was occasionally used in places like Borneo, but apart from there, it wasn't really much used at all. And was used for other things like, you know, fork and spoon or other items you might want to carry close. So that's the two pouches. Across the chest is the strap for the respirator bag. This one is the S6, the standard one, standard issue for the S6 respirator, which was being much more issued at this sort of point. Because when the 58 pattern stuff was introduced, that wasn't available. So you see in some photos of guys in Northern Ireland in 1969 and slightly later as well, with all sorts of different type of respirator bags, from the lightweight respirators and also carrying lightweight respirators themselves. And also the Mark 6 and Mark 7 respirator bags, the early style ones, either to be slung over the shoulder or worn on the chest with the drawstring that goes around the chest itself. So that's the front, and we'll spin it around to the side and we'll crack on with the next part. Okay, now we're on this side. As you can see, the side of the left-hand pouch, obviously with the bayonet, as I've explained, and we see the water bottle. So this is the edition of the second pattern water bottle. With the first pattern, there wasn't a water bottle issued with the webbing at that time. You'll mostly see, when it was first being issued, the use of the 44 pattern water bottle. But with the second pattern, it was introduced in the very early 60s, so this was very much commonplace by that sort of point, but alongside sometimes with the 44 water bottle as well. So water bottle pouch is fairly large. Well, this one is actually a commercially made one as well. I'm not sure when it was made, maybe the 80s or something, but it's a commercially made one, so a slightly different and thinner style twist lock. But it's exactly the same bar. This one is actually slightly larger, so it will fit the water bottle and cup when needed. So that's the carrier. So to open it, just twist the lock like that, and the lid should come open like that. And inside is a 1964 dated water bottle. This one has a black cap. Normally they will have green, but so for some reason when I got the bottle itself, it had the later style lid with the adapter for the tube for the respirator to drink from. So that was a bit of a strange one. I believe that was from the S10, as far as I'm aware, or something later. I'm not entirely sure, but it was a bit of a weird one why that was on a 1964 dated 58 water bottle. But yeah, so the early ones were green. I'm not entirely sure when they introduced the black ones. I'll have to look that up. I believe my friend Simon from the Rifle More channel could probably fill you in a little bit more on that sort of side of things, and I might ask him myself if need be as well. So that's the 58 water bottle with the green one, 1964 dated that one. Obviously the cup sometimes will be in there as well. I don't have a cup spare at the moment, so I don't even know where it's not, but there should normally be one in there. So yeah, so that would hold your water, and that is the general thing of the mannequin. Okay, now we can see the back of the mannequin. So as you can see, so the back of the yoke and the attachment for the entrenching tool, which the entrenching tool itself wasn't used at all in Northern Ireland, for obvious reasons. Mainly because when you're patrolling streets, you don't need a shovel. That's another point. The rest of the strap for the respirator bag, if you can see actually, just slightly actually, the previous owner has actually, I think, pent, like, sort of marked or something, his name and his rank onto the strap itself. So Lieutenant Sherman, I'm guessing, was the previous owner well, whoever this was issued to was a Lieutenant Sherman. The ripcord for the respirator bag as well is on this side. I should have showed you around the other side, but so this would, when being worn over the chest, be tied around the chest to keep it secure, so it doesn't jump about when moving. So, back of the mannequin, we have the field dressing. So this one's a shell dressing. This one, I do have a later one somewhere, but this is sort of a standard for now. This is 1939 dated shell dressing, but it does all the same, basically exactly the same what they were using in the 60s at that point. So shell dressing, sometimes you'll see them taped to the back of the belt or tied with string. I've used this, I have seen in one or two examples, I'll have to find the photos, of them using cord or elasticated something. So I've used twist ties to secure it to the belt. Keeps nice thing, and when you pull it out, they'll snap back and keep to the thing as well. And they're fairly easy to come by, so I thought, and it doesn't ruin the field dressing as well, so I think it's quite a good idea. So that's to the back of the belt to allow you, so if, say, you're injured or something along those lines, this could be quickly got to and then applied to the wound. Now I'm going to twist it around again, and then we'll see the right side of the mannequin. Okay, now we can see the side of the mannequin. So the side profile of the right-hand magazine pouch, obviously with the grenade launcher pockets, obviously was rarely used for that purpose, apart from other things, as I've explained. But we see the front of the respirator bag. So the early style to accompany the 58 webbing with the S6 respirator, so the official one. I believe it's a heavy-duty canvas. I believe it's treated, but I might be wrong on that. Please correct me if I am. fastens down with two snap closures and a quick release tab with a large handle to get a good pull, so when you pull up you can easily access the respirator itself. The later ones would have a snap in the front and then Velcro on the nylon burners that were made later. So in here is the S6, so just the respirator, the filter and the anti-dimming kit. You didn't carry MBC full kit because you weren't be coming into contact with anything like that. The only reason you would have it is, say, where the troops or someone deploys tear gas or something to that effect. That will be used in that sort of situation. So the respirator's inside there. I'll just open it up for you. So S6 is in there. It's got this store tag on it still. I believe that's a store tag or something there. So both the respirator and the bag are 1967 dated ones. The respirator is made by Avon. So that's the side there. Cut again, and we'll spin it round and we'll show you the back. Quick thing to add on the end of the mannequin part. Obviously I mentioned the pouches for the magazines. So each of these pouches will hold about two magazines for the self-loading rifle. So the L1A1 SLR, the British adaptation of the FN FAL by Belgium, so Fabrique Nationale FN. I will state this now, the SLR for this period is slightly incorrect. So the SLR in 1969 would have wood furniture on it, so wooden handguards, wooden pistol grip and wooden buttstock. The plastic furniture, there is a certain name for the plastic furniture itself, it's the composites of the plastic itself, is the certain word type of plastic it is. It wasn't introduced until, say, the mid-70s. I am planning to get if I can afford it, a real wood kit for this, or if that's not possible, airsoft wooden kit for it, and then do a little bit of work to it to sort of make it look a bit more realistic. for reenactments. I wouldn't use the wooden kit in an airsoft game. And so, yeah, this is an airsoft SLR. Real ones are a pretty, pretty penny these days. So, yeah, the wood kit would be part of the... would be the norm then, obviously, because the plastic version shouldn't come in yet. So, L1A1 SLR, 7.62 by, I think it's 59, as far as I remember. Please correct me if I'm wrong. But, yeah, 7.62 cartridge. Feeds from a 20-round box magazine. The charging handle is there, so... Charging handle, select switch, only in semi-automatic, so safe and semi-automatic. There was no fully automatic on the British version because the ordnance board and basically the government, well, sort of ministry, saw it as it was unnecessary to have a fully automatic rifle in this calibre because it was next to useless, really, in fully automatic. You could try to do burst fire with it, but in general, only your first round would probably be on target. Everything after that is up in the sky. So they settled with semi-automatic, which I think really put it down as one of the better interpretations of the FN FAL. So gas system at the top, select switch as I showed you on the side. So safe and semi-automatic. Release catch for the SLR is here. So say when holding the weapon, your free hand, depending on, well, I'm right-handed, so I'm holding this. Free hand, push the lever, magazine comes out like so. I believe I have shown this in a previous video, probably on the para video, where I'll go into some detail about it there, I believe, as far as I remember. So if you want another little thing on there, it's in there as well. Sights, flip-up sight, great addition. Yes, it can be a little bit wobbly, but at the end of the day, when not in use, the sight will be put down. When in use, the sight will be up. It allows you to put it away and doesn't get snagged on things or broken, like some of the fixed sights on other FN variants. So yeah, amazing rifle. As I said, previously to this, just while we're going over the mannequin, the sling, so the front of the sling would be taken off the front loop and looped around the wrist. This sort of became normal practice going into 1917 and onwards from that. Basically, you stop the weapon being taken from you in a crowd control situation, and there were instances of rifles going missing or being stolen during them situations. So yeah, so that'd be it for this, and we're just going to cut to for the roundup. So that's that for that video. So obviously that was showing the British Army, so Royal Hampshire Regiment, in Northern Ireland in 1969 in Belfast. So if any questions, please post them in the comments down below. Feel free to like, comment and subscribe. And please visit, I have a Facebook page called British Army, A Century at War. I'll put a link down to the page in the description below. And also put a link down in the description to a friend of the channel, Simon from the Rough and More channel, which I mentioned in the video. He's been a great help, and gave me a shout out in one of his previous videos from Matt Green. I helped him with some photos and some footage at the event, so that was really good. It was a very great event as well. Obviously, it's been a while since my last video, not my last video, but the one before that. So just filming's been a bit sort of haphazard, really, lately. So yeah, as I said. Really appreciate it if you've watched. Hope you like it. As I said, so like, comment, and subscribe. And I will see you soon. Bye.